Chinmay would have already told you a little bit about free RTOS. So I'm going to dig a little bit deeper into the same topic. But don't worry, it's not an RTOS course. That would take a whole semester, of course. So I'm going to tell you why free RTOS is used, especially in IoT. So to begin with, okay, I think this is a redundant slide, but I still put it there. We all know what is IoT. But the basic 4 points is what I want you to look at. Internet-enabled, connected devices, and they form a network, and they obviously, you know, transmit data. What is RTOS, real-time operating system? Well, first, it's real-time, and one of the examples which was given by Chinmay was the NeoPixel. It's a pretty tricky thing to program, especially if you have a Raspberry Pi. And it has to multitask. You need a lot of different tasks to be running in parallel. You need real-time scheduling, wherein you bring different tasks at different time lapses or, you know, time frames. And also, you need a low memory footprint. If you had good memory, you would use an operating system. You wouldn't use an RTOS. And another important point is it's configurable to different sizes. So you can have an RTOS for 22 KB, 10 KB, 5 KB, and all the way up to 4 or 5 MB of, you know, size. So quickly, let me tell you about the basics. The three things which I felt was most important. The first thing is it's all about the scheduler. You need to have a real-time scheduler. The basic difference to explain to you in a very naive way is in an operating system like Windows or Linux, where you have a scheduler, the scheduler focuses more on responsiveness, how responsive the UI is, how quickly the user gets what he wants. But in an RTOS, it's more about process. It's more about how the processes are finished to completion, because there is not, mostly there's no user involved at all. So this is the basic difference in terms of scheduler. The second thing is tick. So yeah, tick is a pretty complex thing to explain, but I'll tell you quickly. So the seconds of a clock are tick. In a microcontroller or a microprocessor, you always have tick. But when you have big operating systems, your tick is not real time. It is generally sourced from a software timer, which can have a few cycles of lag now and then. But in case of a real time operating system, your tick is sourced directly from your processor cycles. So it's going to be real time. And you can configure this tick in case of an RTOS. You can have it to be 1 second, 1 millisecond, 1 microsecond, all the way up to picoseconds. And the third important thing is you have limited task states. So if you can see this diagram, forgive me for the crazy URLs. I don't like to use other people's work without credit. So you have very limited task states over here. You just have ready, running, blocked, and suspended. But if you look at Linux, you have like at least 20 different task states apart from these. And another thing to note over here is these are all different components of an RTOS, which I won't go into much detail. But if you see, they are pretty limited. This whole bubble here represents every software feature that an RTOS can give you. You have message queues, pipes, mailboxes, mutex, semaphores. Yeah, these are things that change from RTOS to RTOS, but this is the most basic one. So yeah, that's it for RTOS basics. Okay, now this slide, I'll tell you a little bit about industry perspective. Okay, so being someone who has worked both on full big operating systems as well as real-time operating systems, I can tell you how an industry works in case of both. So if you see this is a Linux operating system, but many people who develop applications have a similar OS structure which is based on Unix or Linux or their own proprietary OS maybe. Generally, each layer that you see here is handled by a different set of engineers, a different department or so. And let's take system libraries for example. In an industry that, you know, supplies customers, your system libraries are generally handled by 70 plus engineers. That's how it was in one of the companies I worked for. So each layer over here is like roughly 30 to 40 engineers at the least. So you can imagine the number of people that it takes to, you know, build up a system like this. But when you come to RTOS, roughly 7 people work on the real-time OS. That's it. It's like 1/10 the amount of people who work on a particular layer in a full operating system like Linux. And drivers, generally, most drivers are developed by one person, single hand. Because when you come to a real-time operating system, your components are tiny. It's easy to maintain your code, so you don't need a lot of people to maintain drivers. So this whole stack that you see here can be anywhere between as less as, you know, 1% to 20 people. But this most certainly cannot be managed by one person, single hand. You might have to use pre-built libraries or pre-built kernel. Yeah, many people don't write there. kernel from scratch.
Okay.
So yeah, this is a basic, you know, and an industry perspective between what happens when you develop with an RTOS and when you develop with a, you know, full-time operating system. So yeah, a little bit about where you would use it, you know, when you have IoT. So this is a small little curve that I took from a presentation online. So you can see the processor power. When it's very less, you really might not want an RTOS. You can write your own super loop and everything is handled by that. It is actually done. In an Arduino, people who do simple operations like, you know, Blinky or Blinky with a motor, it's just a super loop. You don't use an RTOS. That's like crazy. As you, you know, have little more processing power and you want to do more things, you start using RTOS. It's like free RTOS, which is free, less amount of guarantees, and yeah, basically it's free. If you go for more advanced operations, you might use UC Linux, and there's another operating system called ECOS. Or if you have really advanced, like you have customers who are demanding, you know, picoseconds of delay, you might use real-time Linux where you build your own kernel. You can't, you know, just take a kernel from the market. So yeah, this graph kind, and if you have more power, if the curve is extended on the x-axis, you can use Ubuntu if you have the budget that allows you to do that. Okay. Yeah, this slide is something, you know, that came to me while I was sleeping and I woke up with this idea. Multitasking is a necessary evil. So in IoT, especially tiny devices, you can't have the device do just one thing. That's not the way it is. And ideally, an IoT device will do at least two things. One is maintain connectivity, be it Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, NFC, LoRa. And the second thing is what it's designed for. You don't just design a device to connect to the internet. You want it to collect some data, temperature, pressure, and whatever. So if you can see this small, you know, chip over here, it has four motors connected to it. It has a buzzer, and it also is connected to Wi-Fi. So right there you have, you know, three tasks that I listed. So multitasking is a necessary evil, and this is another reason why you need an OS that schedules between different tasks. Okay. So this is a small slide that tells you about development times. It's not very important, but still I'll tell you. Small companies, especially startups, prefer to, you know, develop their own tiny kernel, which is kind of like an RTOS in itself, but it's completely proprietary. Since you build it from scratch, you own everything. You don't need to reveal it to the user, nothing. So a lot of companies take this approach, but if you see, there are a lot of things that are involved in the software timeline. You have to design your own hardware. You have to design your own software, you have to make the hardware, so it takes a much longer time. But let's say you use an RTOS, a commercially available RTOS like Free RTOS or ECOS or one of them. You just need to build the hardware, you don't need to build the software. The software is ready for you. So it actually reduces your development time, and a lot of startups are actually picking up Free RTOS. If you look at a lot of IoT startups in the market, a lot of them use Free RTOS and it's pretty popular. And to, you know, complement this, there's a company in Singapore called TUV SUV. So they are working with Free RTOS and they have made another variant called Safe RTOS, which is, I think, ISO certified. Let me just show it to you. So this company is in Singapore, by the way, and they have worked with Free RTOS to make this operating system called Safe RTOS, and it has a great deal of certifications. It is certified to be used in nuclear power plants. I don't know where that slide is, but if you have a chance, go take a look at this. There's a pretty nice photo where they show that, you know, it's safe to use in a nuclear power plant, but yeah, you can check that out later. Okay. And this is another small example of an application called Napto. So FreeRTOS themselves have built this Napto, and it's basically a P2P connection that can go over firewalls. It's pretty interesting, and if you see the diagram, it's a pretty intuitive way to use an IoT device. You can have a UDP request directly to your device physically, and let's say you want to have fancy graphics and, you know, your JavaScript applications, you can run it on a server. So you have a lot of, you can make build really good UIs using this type of software. And if you don't want a UI, you can just have your P2P connection with UDP. And there are three other configurations. You can check that out on the FreeRTOS website. It's actually built by FreeRTOS, which comes at a price, of course. This is not free. And in the end, networking isn't just enough. So this is a small screenshot of the Embed OS. and you can just see the amount of, you know, crazy software that are put in. They have C++ APIs, event framework, threads. So at the end, networking isn't just enough. You need to support much more things apart from networking. You need to support multiple forms of networking. So for all this, you really can't do just without an OS. So hence, you need something like an RTOS. Okay, so this slide just, you know, summarizes whatever I showed you in images. And in the end, I'll just focus on the last point of it. In some cases, real-time behavior is actually needed. So examples, I think three of them were highlighted by Chinmay, so I won't be going in. Okay, so in some cases, real-time behavior is actually needed, and you need to have an RTOS working inside. So I have a small little demo, which is prepared on this board called Realtek Amoeba. If any NTU students are here, last year I think Realtek conducted a competition inside NTU where I got this board. So it's a pretty tiny, it's nothing that you guys haven't seen. It's a Cortex M3 which runs at 166 MHz with 512 KB RAM. Something similar to the Arduino DUI to give you a sense of comparison. It's pretty similar to the Arduino DUI minus the Wi-Fi antenna and the NFC chip over here. Yeah. And the best part about this is it supports Arduino, it supports IAR, and it has a GCC toolchain support which is upcoming. So a lot of different people can take this up, and that's all about the board. Let me go for the demo. So what I'm going to do with this board is, it is running FreeRTOS, it's there on my table, it's running off a battery by the way, it's not over here. So if any of you have a laptop, you can connect to this SSID, which I have shown here. You can put the password and you can open the stream over there. If you want, go ahead and try it, otherwise I'll open and show it to you. And once you see the stream, I'll explain what's happening in the moment.
Yeah,
okay. Amoeba. I just showed
it. Amoeba.
The A is caps. I don't know how many people can connect to the stream, but yeah, the stream is. Can you just pan the camera?
Nice.
Yeah. Okay, I'll just get that over here to show you guys how tiny it is. Okay, I'm sorry, the password is 1234567. I'm sorry for that. Yeah, but that's the password. You can try it. I don't know how many streams it will support simultaneously because it's a tiny real-time operating system. But give it a try. Let's see how far it can go. Anyone else got the stream? You are it. Okay, yeah. Anyone else got the stream?
What's the password again?
1234567.
9.
Yeah, till 9. 129s, all the days. No one else got the stream? Okay, fine. Okay, so. Yeah, you can try it later, I'll keep it on.
Yeah.
So what's happening here, there are actually three really important things that are happening. One is the video decoding. So this camera supports UVC, USB video class. So it's a UVC driver that's there inside this camera, and it transmits motion JPEG frames. So the first stack that I wrote is motion JPEG decoding, of course. So that's running on the board in real time at 30 frames per second. The image quality is low because it has very, very less RAM. I can't have a frame that exceeds 18 KB because there's only 150 KB of RAM. And the next thing that's running is an RTSP stream. So RTSP is the protocol by which I'm streaming to VLC. So there's an RTSP stack running inside that again accepts the stream at 30 frames per second and, you know, encodes it to the RTSP format and transmits it over the Wi-Fi AP, for which you need a Wi-Fi stack, which is also running. So there are three things that are running in parallel, and the stream is somewhat real time. There will be a delay. You can't expect zero delays. So there's a delay and a lot of things. These delays can be attributed to the Wi-Fi modem, to the delay in the software, and to the delay in which the PC actually responds and gets the packet and shows it on the screen. So there are a lot of delays involved, but it can be faster, I think. I think there's a 5-second delay the last time. So roughly 5 seconds. So that's the delay. But it's somewhat real-time-ish. Not very real-time, but if you see the kind of protocol stacks that are running are very heavy. You have motion JPEG decoding, Wi-Fi stack, and an RTSP server all running in the same processor. And it's powered off a battery. This is the whole setup here. You can power it off a AA battery as well if you have the adapter. I have done it with a AA battery. Single AA battery, and it runs for 8 to 10 hours. So this is a 10,400 mAh battery, so I think it will run for a week. Which is okay if you want to do video surveillance of an event or something. You can have better camera support, but again, the limitation that I'm facing right now is the 150 KB of RAM. So if the RAM was bigger, we could have gone for something like H.264, which gives you 1080p HD video. But yeah, right now that's not possible with such a tiny device. That's the end of my... the benefits of using FreeRTOS is... I think I already told you all this. It's a redundant slide. And further reading, you can read a lot about these things. FreeRTOS.org if you want to read about FreeRTOS. This is the official website of the board on which I'm showing you the demo. If you want to buy the board, the link is there. And this is a pretty nice course from Rutgers University about real-time scheduling, which actually tells you why you need real-time scheduling. And the last one is the FreeRTOS Snapto, the B2B application that I was talking about, which is made by FreeRTOS. So if you want to do some further reading, these are the options you have. And any questions?
The questions to the end.
Okay, thank you.